Hello and welcome to the International Daily Roundup with People's Dispatch, where we bring you some of the top stories from across the globe. Let's take a look at today's headlines. ALBA movements warn of coup attempt against Peru's government. Lebanon's government raises fuel prices amid critical shortages. Tunisian President Kais Saied extends suspension of parliament. Nabisco workers' strike for a fair contract expands across the US. And in our video section, we take a look at the Zycov-D vaccine approved by the Indian government. ALBA Movimientos has warned of a coup against Peru's left-wing president Pedro Castillo. The organization is composed of over 400 social movements across 25 Latin American countries. It is argued that the coup strategy of right-wing forces is focused on Peru's Congress. An opposition alliance led by Maria del Carmen Alba won the vote to lead the body in July. Alba will serve as president of the Congress, in which the right now holds a majority. Congress has filed a record 19 motions to question 7 ministers in just 15 days. ALBA has warned that there is a threat of no confidence facing the new cabinet. It further adds that reactionary sectors are trying to use the figure of presidential vacancy due to moral incapacity. The group has also highlighted the racism and aggression against Castillo during the election. The statement by the group follows shortly after the forced resignation of Foreign Minister Hector Bejar. It argues that this marked the start of a counter-offensive and ultra-reactionary coup. Right-wing forces are also trying to appoint new members to the Constitutional Court. ALBA has stated that there is an effort to block the reforms promised by Castillo. There is also an attempt to block regulations and checks on corruption. Lebanon's government has raised the price of fuel by 66% amid widespread shortages. The central bank announced this month that it would not pay for fuel imports at subsidized rates. In an effort to contain the impact, the government reached a deal with the bank. The prices have been raised, but subsidized imports will continue for now. However, Al-Akhbar has cited sources saying that subsidies will be permanently lifted by the end of September. The Lebanese military has also seized fuel from petrol stations and storage tankers to prevent hoarding. Meanwhile, shootings have been reported amid long lines at stations. The army was distributing confiscated fuel in Akkar on August 15th. It was then that the tanker exploded, killing at least 33 people and injuring over 80. Affected families have demanded financial assistance and a transparent investigation into the matter. Lack of fuel combined with medical shortages have also pushed Lebanon's health system near collapse. Private hospitals provide 80% of the medical services in the country. Many are either shutting down or turning away patients who cannot pay. Shortages of basic supplies such as saline solutions are also being reported. Millions of people are also at risk of critical water shortages or being cut off from safe water supplies completely. Tunisian President Kais Saied has suspended the country's parliament indefinitely. The immunity granted to members of the legislative body also remains suspended. Saied assumed executive authority after ousting Prime Minister Hichem Mechichi on July 25th. Saied justified the move on the basis of Article 80 of the Constitution. However, the article states that the parliament must remain in session, which in this case did not happen. The action followed mass protests against the government across several cities. Protesters denounced the mishandling of the pandemic and demanded socio-economic reforms. At the time, Tunisia was witnessing a surge in COVID-19 deaths amid low vaccination rates. Since then, the country has been recording an average of over 2,400 new cases every day for the past 3 weeks. The total death toll as of August 24th stands at 22,609. President Saied announced last month that the army would take over the COVID-19 response. Meanwhile, several officials and former ministers have been placed under house arrest. Saied had also stated that he would appoint a new prime minister. However, a decision has not yet been announced. In our next story, we go to the US, where a strike by Nabisco company workers has spread countrywide. Over 1,000 workers across 5 states have walked off the job to demand a fair contract. They are members of Bakery, Confectionery, Tobacco Workers and Grain Millers International. The strike, which began in Oregon, has now spread to Illinois, Georgia, Colorado and Virginia. Workers are protesting low wages and long shifts extending up to 12 to 16 hours. They have also denounced the concessions proposed by Nabisco and its parent company, Mondelez International. These include an alternative work schedule under which workers would have 12-hour shifts. The company is also trying to eliminate overtime pay for extended hours and weekends. Instead, workers would be paid regular rates till they hit 40 hours a week. It has also proposed a two-tier healthcare system, which would mean that new hires would have to pay more. Mondelez has also eliminated pensions of workers and retirees in 2018. And for a final story, we look at the latest in COVID-19 vaccine development. Zydus Cadila's vaccine candidate has been approved for emergency use in India. ZyCoV-D is a three-dose vaccine with a needle-free applicator. It can also be stored at a temperature of 25 degrees Celsius for 3 months. The vaccine has demonstrated a primary efficacy of 66.6% in stage 3 trials. Higher antibody levels have been found in children between the ages of 12 and 18 years. Here's Dr. Satyajit Rath to talk more about the vaccine.
Other interesting issue that I was looking at is when you look at the figures, these are comparable to what I would say the Oxford AstraZeneca figures are in terms of protective immunity or whatever we can call it. And it seems to be lower than the mRNA vaccines. Now, are they really apple to apple comparable, or are these figures just basically artifacts of the experiments that we are doing in terms of clinical trials?
So I've been saying this for very many months, to the point of boredom now, that unless a planned comparison is made, comparing numbers from independent trials really doesn't mean anything. And let me use the Zydus Cadila example to give specific instances of that. In the first place, their trial has been over these past few months, which means that in quite likely probability, that this vaccine has been dealing with a lot of the Delta variant.
That's correct.
All the other vaccines were tested last year, so this is pre-Delta variant time, number one. Number two, if you look at the press release, so far we are just dealing with press release information, but if you look at the press release says that mild symptomatic infection showed a 66 point something percent protective efficacy. But it says, without actually giving total numbers, nonetheless, it says there were no cases of moderate to severe infection in the vaccinated group, which they, in the press release, are claiming as complete protection against moderate to severe illness. So if you look at all of this, as far as I can see, this vaccine falls in exactly the same category from these claims, not from independent peer-reviewed publications, but from a publicity claim. It falls in the same category as all the other vaccines broadly fall in. Unless we have actual comparison studies, we won't be able to go much beyond that. But I think we can be certain that severe illness, disease, and death will be as well protected against by this vaccine as by all the other vaccines, which is an extremely useful addition to the COVID-19 portfolio of instruments.
And that's all the time we have for this episode of the International Daily Roundup. For more such stories and videos, visit our website, peoplesespy.org, subscribe to our YouTube channel, follow us on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram. Thank you for watching.